When she was born, she was the most beautiful baby I have ever seen in my life. She had the biggest cherry lips. She was precious.
Bear was a full-term baby. Everything was completely normal. We had scheduled a C-section, and then the next day, we had the people come in with the big machine to do the newborn hearing screen. It took about 20 minutes, and she said, yeah, he's not passing this hearing screen, but it's probably fine. He was a C-section baby, so there's probably fluid in his ears, so I'll just come back tomorrow and repeat the test. And we were like, okay, never even gave it another thought.
When she was born, she did not pass the newborn hearing screen. Throughout the months, we noticed that some things weren't quite right with my daughter. She would respond to some sounds, but she wouldn't respond to other sounds.
She came back the next day, did the test again with the same results that he wasn't passing. And, you know, you're in that kind of like that newborn fog, and you're kind of just like, what is this? Like, there's no history of hearing loss or deafness in our family. This really came out of the left field. We were shocked, in denial, but also, maybe this is actually like a real thing that we need to start thinking about.
Hearing for a lot of families is kind of the default way that we access the same communication system as our parents. And the thing about hearing loss is that you can't tell for the most part without testing whether or not they will be typically hearing or if they might be identified as deaf or hard of hearing. And so that testing is crucial to really be able to identify which infants need further follow-up.
I had Yanine on my lap. She was going through this book, and they started the test. The noises were extremely loud to a certain point. And my daughter, she was not responding to anything. At that moment, I just started crying. I felt as if my world had just shattered in pieces. I was heartbroken, blaming myself. Why did I not see this sooner? At that time, it was the worst day of my life.
And so then we came back 2 weeks later. He did the test and it was the same results. He's not passing. And so that at that point, we were referred to do an official ABR. And when he was 2 months old, and that's where we had the official diagnosis of his moderate to severe hearing loss. Then we were like, what do we do with this information that we have? It was really overwhelming.
And at that point, then it's thinking about everything from the next few weeks to the next 18 years, right? Well, what does this mean?
I remember getting home. I remember crying, laying in bed with my baby, but I said, no, my daughter has me. I need to advocate for her needs. We need to move on to the next step. So what's next?
Our 136 guidelines, that's kind of our mantra for early hearing detection and intervention, refers to the number of months by which certain events should happen. In an ideal world, we would want every infant to receive an initial newborn hearing screen by 1 month of age. If that screen is not passed, we want every infant to receive a full diagnostic evaluation performed by a pediatric audiologist by 3 months of age, which would then provide an identification that an infant is deaf or hard of hearing. And then, most importantly of all, we would want intervention services, establishing care with an otolaryngologist or a pediatric audiologist, all of the follow-up testing, speech and language services, communication monitoring, we would want all of that to happen by 6 months of age.
If we hadn't done that screening and had that ABR and seen the actual data to know that, yes, this is a real thing and this is the level of it and here's the resources from now on to know how to deal with it, it would have been really easy, even seeing signs of any hearing loss without having those official results, to say, no, it's probably not that, right? And he's probably fine, we'll wait till he gets older and, you know, see then if maybe this is a thing. But had we done that, we would have lost a lot of really precious time in intervening and improving his life.
We say Bear was our guinea pig to this whole world because he kind of was like the slow intro. So this is Mila and she's deaf and she wears cochlear implants. She was implanted at 14 months old. And this is Bear and he wears hearing aids on both sides and he loves his hearing aids. He loves to talk. He loves to listen to music, but he also really likes to sign.
Say, my name is Bear.
My name is Bear, yeah.
This is my baby. That beautiful, the most beautiful baby I had ever seen in my life. It's almost 17 years ago. She has been bilaterally implanted with cochlear implants. She has had a very bright and successful outcome. She's a straight A student.
My mom, she always encouraged me. She always makes sure I'm doing everything good in school and make sure I have speech every year. That's the reason why I am talking today.
They have just really blossomed in every area. They have great access to English, spoken English, and they are in an ASL immersive environment at school. And so both languages are developing really simultaneously and beautifully.
Parents having deaf baby is very special.
The 136 guidelines are very important. You can't get that time back. You have to take advantage, push it through. You will encounter many barriers, but what is really important is do not give up.
What I want to tell them is that your journey is just beginning. I recognize that first initial diagnosis can be hard to hear if it wasn't what you were expecting to hear. But the thing is that you have a wealth of resources at your disposal. You have practitioners and you have early intervention specialists, and there is a giant network of people here, and you are at the center of that.
The most important thing that I'd say to these parents is it will be okay. Resources are out there.
For all of you families out there that are holding that infant that has been newly identified, this is you guys in four years. And I hope that it encourages you that it's gonna be just fine.
Yeah, if we didn't follow the 136 program and understand what we had access to and all the resources that were available to us, we would have just probably been in a constant state of being overwhelmed, like these kids
like
are
right now.